Okay, and the final item of business this evening is a members' business debate on motion 8819 in the name of Michelle Thompson on Tercentenary of Adam Smith. The debate will be concluded without any questions being put, and then invite members who wish to participate to press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible. And I invite Michelle Thompson to open the debate around 7 minutes. Ms. Thompson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Now, I give these opening remarks with some trepidation, as I know many esteemed academics will be speaking about the Tercentenary of Adam Smith through the course of this week. I congratulate the vigour with which Professor Graeme Roy and Roger Mullen have pursued celebrations in Glasgow University and in Kirkcaldy, respectively. Indeed, the inaugural event by Glasgow University was held in this Scottish Parliament, and that is fitting. This place, as Smith expressed in his theory of moral sentiments, should ideally be where to feel much for others and little for ourselves, to restrain our selfishness and exercise our benevolent affections, constitute the perfection of human nature. Now, there are many people in Scotland who recognise the name Adam Smith, yet too few of those and the tourists who walk past his statue on the High Street of Edinburgh, Panmure House, or his grave at the Canongate know of his lasting impact. Now, whilst we do not know his exact date of birth, we do know that Smith was baptised on the 5th of June 1723 in Kirkcaldy, Old Kirk. Smith studied logic, metaphysics, maths, Newtonian physics and moral philosophy at Glasgow University. After a short spell at Oxford University, he returned to Glasgow University, becoming a lecturer and then the rector. He then moved to Panmure House in Edinburgh, where he died in 1790. He was a leading figure in the Scottish Enlightenment that produced a quite remarkable outpouring of ideas, spanning a wide range of areas, including engineering, chemistry, political economy, philosophy, literature, medicine, and many other areas of intellectual life. The Scottish universities, not least Glasgow University, were central to this in providing a home for the exchange of ideas across disciplines. Influenced greatly by Francis Hutcheson, the Glasgow University professor and philosopher, and alongside his friends David Hume, Joseph Black, James Hutton, Dougal Stewart and Robert Burns, they took Scotland to the world. It's no coincidence that in the 1760s, Voltaire, whom Smith visited many times in France, noted, "We look to Scotland for all our ideas of civilization." The Scottish Enlightenment asserted the importance of human reason, expresses ideas, and a rejection of any stance that could not be justified by reason. Arguably, our current political world has much still to learn. But of course, he's best known as one of the founding fathers of economics, with his ideas permeating economic theories today. Some would say that to understand his political economy, you must first have read and understood his theory of moral sentiments. This articulates that we are, above all else, social beings and that our morality, or in today's language, our empathy, is guided by that fact. Where reason is important, it is trumped by the themes set out in this book, namely prudence, justice, beneficence, and self-command, all of which are underpinned and developed by conscience or morality. And again, there's much in this book to guide us in this Parliament. And I quote again, "We are but one of the multitude in no respect better than any other in it." Or perhaps more colloquially put by Robert Burns, "We're all Jack Tamson's bairns." Smith goes on, "The prudent man is always sincere and feels horror at the very thought of exposing himself to the disgrace which attends upon the detection of falsehood." His three natural laws of economics, the law of self-interest, the law of competition, and the law of supply and demand, were laid out in his lectures in Glasgow University. Now, many of these concepts are fundamentally misunderstood and have been misappropriated, not least of all by the Adam Smith Institute in London. By the time he wrote The Wealth of Nations in 1776, Smith had seen corruption and unfettered imperialism mixed with power held in the hands of just a few. The requirement for balance between competition, capitalism and a free market, known as the invisible hand, points to what we would now regard as an acute need for sustainability in economic growth. He too had commentary to make about sensible trade, citing an example of winemaking in Scotland. Just because we could doesn't mean to say we should if the bottom line cost of said trade is not commercially viable. And he was clear about the damage caused by tariffs. I suggest that some Brexit-supporting Conservatives are going to have to reread this particular section in The Wealth of Nations. Perhaps in my closing remarks, I can return to Professor Graham Roy and draw from an article he wrote in December 2022. I quote, "Crucially, Smith is a political economist and not just interested in understanding economic trends. He seeks to make the case for the institutions and structures in our society, such as the shape of markets, to be cohesive, fair and resilient. As we face complex intergenerational and global challenges, be it the climate emergency, rising inequality or the cost of living crisis, there's much we can apply from Smith's writings to today." Roy finishes with, "In today's often toxic political culture and binary policy debates, a recognition that the big global policy challenges that we face require careful thought and, above all, respectful discourse between different sides of an argument. The use of reason, you could argue, and it's perhaps the greatest lesson we can learn from one of Scotland's most famous sons. I look forward to the next 300 years of global influence." Thank you, Adam Smith, and thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Ms Thompson. We now move to the open debate. I call first Liz Smith, to be followed by Ivan McKee. Around 4 minutes, Ms Smith.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I very much welcome this motion put forward by Michelle Thompson, celebrating the tercentenary of the birth of Adam Smith, a man who was such a profound influence on the Scottish Enlightenment and, of course, on political economy across the world. Points I highlighted in my own parliamentary motion, and I entirely associate myself with the remarks that Michelle Thompson has stated, particularly her last point about the discourse in respectful terms. I think that's a very important lesson. Now, I vividly recall when I was taking up my first teaching post in economics, I was handed a copy of The Wealth of Nations and told to inspire my young charges, who at that age were just 14 and 15. Well, that is actually the age that Smith started university. And I was told that if they didn't immediately come to terms with the principles of taxation, then I should tell them about Smith's abduction by travellers, aged four, or that an asteroid is named after him, or about the making of a pin. That, I was told, would capture their imagination. Advice to ponder, perhaps, as you embark on a teaching career that inevitably involved inspiring young minds to recognise one of the true greats in Scottish history, who had written an inquiry into the nature and causes of the Wealth of Nations and the theory of moral sentiments. Probably not bedside reading for most 14, 15-year-olds, but that was precisely the challenge that made economics come alive for me. Now, Winston Churchill famously said, "Of all the small nations of this earth, perhaps only the ancient Greeks can surpass the Scots in their contribution to mankind." Considering the immense wealth of talent and innovation generated by this nation over the last few centuries, it would certainly be difficult to pinpoint a single person to top the list. But I think there is a robust and valid case to argue that that individual is Adam Smith. His influence really is profound, felt across so many aspects of life, in economics, in politics, in philosophy, education, and the list could go on, and I'm sure other members will refer to some of the details. Of course.
Fiona Hislop.
Glasgow University's having studied economic history in the Adam Smith building, I was very struck that it was political economy as set out by Michelle Thompson rather than what might be seen as modern economics that actually his strength was in, and reference to the political side of that political economy is really important.
Liz Smith.
I entirely agree with that, Fiona Hislop. That's exactly my own background in my university degree as well. It's the political economy that I think is so important, and he was very far ahead of his time. when he wrote about political economy. So, yes, you're quite right regarding that. Because, you know, one of the reasons why he was a pioneer of the Scottish Enlightenment was because he transformed intellectual and scientific thinking as well. And he's, you know, widely cited as the father of modern economics. But I think there's far more to what Adam Smith was writing about than just that. And he's always been a very relevant scholar in my own life. His writings were frequently referenced in my economics degree, my teaching career, and actually as an MSP, I actually find some of his thoughts particularly important in the responsibility for the finance and economy brief. Now, not only am I his namesake, but he also came from Kirkcaldy, where my family originated, so who knows, perhaps I should do a bit more digging on the family tree. The economic argument made by Smith that the tax system should be based on equity, certainty, fairness and efficiency are still the central debating points around taxation in the modern day. He argued for free market intervention with low government intervention. He was a champion of the principles of economic growth and wealth creation, an advocate for the division of labour, a concept of the invisible hand, which he actually took from Shakespeare, which determines that an economic system that encourages individualism, enterprise and the freedom of production and consumption are to the benefit of all citizens in society. Now, I suspect this chamber might argue about some of that these days, but in light of what the Scottish Fiscal Commission is telling us, certainly at the Finance Committee just now, I think some of the comments about the taxation agenda, we should be listening very carefully to what Adam Smith has said. So can I just very much welcome this debate from Michelle Thompson. Smith is a colossus of our political economy and thinking, and I very much support the motion in her name.
Thank you, Ms. Smith. And I call Ivan McKee to be followed by Claire Baker. Around 4 minutes, Mr. McKee.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I'd like to begin by paying tribute to Michelle Thompson for bringing this debate to the Parliament today on the Tercentenary of Adam Smith, but also to University of Glasgow and others who have organised events to mark this Tercentenary over this time. I spent a couple of minutes this morning on the wonderful Scotland's People website, and it took me no time at all to dig up Adam Smith's, what they call on the website, his birth certificate, but I think there is some debate about whether that was his birth or his baptism certificate, and naming his parents, of course, is Margaret Douglas and Adam Smith Sr. in Kirkcaldy on the 5th of June 1723. And the reason I mention that is not just to promote the Scotland's ancestry as an opportunity to generate more tourism revenue, but also to demonstrate how easy it is to reach back and touch those events of that time, which are still documented in that way. And I think that speaks to the enduring importance of Adam Smith to this very day. As has been mentioned, his primary recognition, I think, for many, is his generation of economic theory and positioning economics probably for the first time as an academic discipline. And Liz Smith has rhymed off many of the theories for which he was responsible, which underpins so much of economic thinking, of course, to this day. Wealth of Nations articulated, of course, also the theory of absolute advantage, later developed into the theory of comparative advantage by Ricardo and others, which challenged the mercantilism of the day and opened up free trade. And the benefits of that trade continue, of course, to benefit Scottish exports to this day, and frankly are very much in line with the work we took forward as Scottish Government and our export growth plan, a trading nation. But of course, Smith was also a very significant philosopher and part of the Scottish Enlightenment, working with Hume and others. And it's the theory of moral sentiments which is absolutely critical. And of course, that was his first work and underpins his later economic theories, in particular the theory of sympathy, which seeks to explain the source of mankind's ability to form moral judgments. No big ask. There you go. Conscience, of course, arises from, as he stated, dynamic and interactive social relationships through which people seek in mutual sympathy of sentiments. So putting that theoretical basis to understand why people behave as they do, not just in the economic sphere, but in their wider interactions with their fellow citizens. And I think it's that combination of understanding of market drivers, recognising the importance of trade and its theoretical underpinning of trade as a good thing for the most part. And then there's wider considerations of the impact of individuals' actions on others and the importance of the recognition of that, that points to the work of Smith as being, frankly, the forerunner of the conversations we have today around about the concept of the wellbeing economy, reaching out as it does to encompass sustainability, the fair work agenda and much else, recognising that economics and wealth creation is much wider than just the economic theory. I hope that the series of events that have happened over these days have given opportunity for many people, including myself, frankly, to learn more about Smith's work, and that that debate continues, not just for its own sake, but to raise the profile of Smith internationally. And he is a true international figure, widely recognised and revered right across the world. But of course, that not only serves to further Smith's memory, it also, of course, raises Scotland's profile and increases prospects for Scottish trade and exports as a consequence, and I think that's something that Smith himself would approve of. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. McKee. I now call Claire Baker to be followed by David Torrance. Around 4 minutes, Ms. Baker.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I thank Michelle Thompson for bringing this debate to the Chamber. Her speech expertly highlighted the breadth of Adam Smith's work and the significant impact it has had in Scotland and around the globe, and that continues to this present day. The project at the University of Glasgow to commemorate the tercentenary of his birth aims not just to celebrate the work of Adam Smith and its enduring legacy, but to support a better understanding of the breadth and plurality of his work and how the interlocking questions of economics and morality still apply hundreds of years on. Adam Smith is recognised globally as a pioneer in exploring the relationship between politics, economics and social responsibility. His legacy can be found in almost every economic work. And while we recognise the influence of his time at Glasgow University, his roots are in Fife, and particularly Kirkcaldy. He was baptised in Kirkcaldy 300 years ago this week, and yesterday a baptismal celebration was held at the Old Kirk. His education began at home, and it was to Kirkcaldy he returned to spend a lot of time after Glasgow University and his time touring Europe as a tutor to the third Duke of Buccleuch. Later in his life, his post as Commissioner of Customs in Scotland saw him move to Edinburgh, where he had his residence at Panmure House, which is not far from Parliament. But for many years, Kirkcaldy was Adam Smith's home, and many of his ideas developed from his formative experience there. Kirkcaldy was a booming economic centre, and trade and commerce was evident everywhere. From the Old Kirk to the newly refurbished Adam Smith Theatre, his legacy is stamped on the town. And through the Adam Smith Heritage Trail, visitors are encouraged to follow in his footsteps and explore Kirkcaldy, as well as the history of Adam Smith himself, from taking in the Heritage Centre and Adam Smith Close to viewing the first edition of The Wealth of Nations on display at Kirkcaldy Galleries. The Heritage Centre and the Close, which opened in 2016, has been important in terms of raising the profile of Adam Smith within Kirkcaldy itself. Though many people were familiar with the name, his beyond academia, perhaps not so many were aware of his huge global significance or the part that Kirkcaldy has played in his work. Alongside the Glasgow University events and others around the world, a number of events are taking place in Kirkcaldy to celebrate the tercentenary. The annual Adam Smith Festival of Ideas is bigger than ever this year, including an academic programme, a birthday party, which is going to be in the Townhouse Square, and the established food festival, which is on this weekend. There's a series of lectures. The first of these was delivered by Sir Michael Marmot, with subsequent speakers, including Larry Sumners and Robert Peston, who's delivering the annual Adam Smith lecture on Friday. It is not all politics, though. Adam McCall Smith is in conversation tomorrow night, and Arabella Weir, along with Elaine C. Smith, will be presenting Two Doors Down. The Adam Smith Global Foundation is also delivering the academic programme on Thursday and Friday, with lectures across themes such as culture, philosophy, education and economics. Presiding Officer, I cannot talk about the legacy of Adam Smith without reference to Kirkcaldy's other great son when it comes to politics and economics. Gordon Brown has done so much to promote the continuing relevance of Adam Smith to the Langton. The impressive list of, if you let me, Gordon has really been a driver behind the recognition in Kirkcaldy of Adam Smith, and I'll explain how that he has done so much to promote the continuing relevance. of Adam Smith. The impressive list of speakers who've delivered the Adam Smith Lecture in Kirkcaldy is worth highlighting. Sir Tim Berners-Lee, who's the internet founder, Sandy Toltvik, Professor Adam Sandel, UNICEF's Executive Director Henrietta Fore, and Kofi Annan, to name a few. And that was quite a coup for Kirkcaldy to have Kofi Annan visit the town. The Adam Smith Global Foundation has built its reputation and status of its lectures, but it cannot be denied that Gordon Brown's commitment to the legacy for Adam Smith and its relevance to Kirkcaldy has made a huge contribution to the success of the event. I also recognise the active support of the Fife Free Press in supporting and promoting the many events over the years, and particularly in this significant year, as there is much to enjoy and there will be something for everyone this week. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Baker. I now call David Torrens to be followed by Donald Cameron in around 4 minutes. Mr Torrens.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As a Langtonian, it is an absolute pleasure to be speaking in today's debate celebrating the tercentenary of Adam Smith's birth. And I'd like to give my sincere gratitude to Michelle Thompson for securing this important debate. Today we acknowledge the lasting works of Adam Smith and their ongoing relevance in the modern world. His legacy serves as a beacon, reminding us Scotland's historic contributions to global thought and the importance of continuing to celebrate influential Scottish figures. Adam Smith was a multifaceted figure with an intellect that flourished in the fields of engineering, economics, chemistry, political economy, philosophy, literature and medicine. His ideas not only held global importance during his time, but they continue to reverberate through the centuries, influencing society today. I'd like to take a moment to pay tribute to Adam Smith's deep connection to Kirkcaldy. Like me, Adam Smith was born and raised in the Langtoon. In fact, my constituency office, just off the High Street in Kirkcaldy, overlooks Kirkcaldy's old kirk where Adam Smith was baptised 300 years ago. It's a constant reminder of the legacy of a son of Kirkcaldy, and indeed of Scotland, whose life and works have profoundly shaped the world we live in. Adam Smith lived in Kirkcaldy for a great proportion of his life, and his legacy is felt throughout the area and beyond. His legacy was brought enrichment to both locals and tourists of Kirkcaldy and Fife alike. The Langtoon is full of historic moments involving Smith's life, including the Old Kirk, Adam Smith Close, the Adam Smith Heritage Centre, which is a rare example of once common rig buildings in Kirkcaldy on the Esplanade, which was said to have fostered inspiration for Smith's work, The Wealth of Nations, and most recently Adam Smith Theatre, which is set to reopen. This year, to celebrate his 300th anniversary, Kirkcaldy will be putting Adam Smith firmly in the spotlight and honouring his legacy at various events across the town. I'm so pleased that the organised events have attracted so many from across the country to experience Adam Smith's hometown and the contributions he has made to it. Fife College Scholarship Programme also launched the new Adam Smith 300 Enterprise Scholarship on the day of Adam Smith's 300th anniversary. Aimed at supporting students taking steps into setting up their own business, it will include financial support, as well as mentoring support and guidance from Business Gateway Fife. This is great news for students and a fantastic way to celebrate this milestone. It is impressive to recognise the pivotal role Scottish universities have played in fostering Scottish figures, including spreading Adam Smith's transformative ideas. It was at our Scottish universities where Adam Smith's spiritual curiosity, formidable intellect were cultivated, along with several other Scottish economists and philosophers. Our world-leading Scottish universities have provided space for ideas to flourish, ideas that would forever change the course of Scottish and global human society. As we commemorate this momentous occasion, let us remember that it is crucial to continue to celebrate the life and works of influential Scottish figures. Their legacy serves as a reminder of invaluable contributions Scotland has made to the world. Adam Smith, an intellectual giant, a man of unquenchable curiosity, a product of the Scottish Enlightenment, is a shining testament to this. Adam Smith was leading light in Scottish Enlightenment, the extraordinary intelligence thinking of the 18th century, which forever altered our understanding of the world. Scottish Enlightenment, with Adam Smith at its vanguard, was an outpouring of intellectual and scientific creativity by Scottish theorists. This work gained global recognition for its assertion of the importance of human reasoning and the use of empirical methods of inquiry. This was a seismic shift away from a dogma and authority to a world where application of reason, observation and experiment became our guiding principles. The great thinkers of the Scottish Enlightenment, including Adam Smith, have influenced the culture of Scotland in several areas, including architecture, art, music and philosophy. The influence of this movement spread from beyond Scotland, moving ideas and dissemination of ideas. Of course, Scotland has changed in innovative ways since Adam Smith's death. Although his ideas continue to be of global significance for 300 years after his birth, Countries all over the world have faced unprecedented economic challenges which time and time again have tested the relevance of modern economic policy. However, despite the changes and challenges we faced, Adam Smith's light continues to shine brilliantly in disciplines as diverse as engineering, economics, chemistry, political economy, philosophy, literature and medicine. We must continue to celebrate his inquisitive nature, his analytical mind and his inclination to question the world. It is crucial to champion these values as policymakers and decision makers as we strive to build society that is not only economically prosperous but also socially equitable and just. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, let us in the spirit of Smith continue to pursue knowledge and understanding, to question, to analyse and to innovate. For as Adam Smith himself says, science is a great antidote to a poison of enthusiasm and superstition.
Thank you, Mr. Torrance. I now call Donald Cameron to be followed by Claire Adamson around 4 minutes. Mr. Cameron.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I begin by thanking, like others, Michelle Thompson for bringing this debate about Adam Smith into the chamber, which is very timely for the many reasons that she mentioned. It's been an incredible amount of impressive contributions so far. I feel like I've been back to school already in the last sort of half an hour. I have many things that have been said are what I'm going to say, so I will try and be brief. The year 1776 is one of those years in human history that can quite properly be described as remarkable. And the reason for that is that three seminal texts in the English language were published. The first of these was the Declaration of Independence in America. The second was the renowned historical work by Edward Gibbon, The Decline and Fall of the Roman Empire. And the third was The Nature and Causes of the Wealth of Nations, the first work of political economy, as we now know it now, The Wealth of Nations by Adam Smith. And it's rightly known throughout the world as a seminal work, establishing as it did the doctrine of free trade and the concepts of modern liberal economics that we have, that we practice today and we've heard about already. I've also got my own personal connection to that text, because in Book 3, Chapter 4, an ancestor of mine gets a mention. Adam Smith is speaking here of the heritable jurisdictions that exist across the world, and he says this: "It's not 30 years ago since Mr. Cameron of Lochiel, a gentleman of Lochaber in Scotland, without any legal warrant whatever, not being what was then called a lord of regality, nor even a tenant-in-chief, but a vassal of the Duke of Argyll, without being so much as a justice of the peace, used, notwithstanding, to exercise the highest criminal jurisdiction over his own people. He is said to have done so with great equity, though without any of the formalities of justice, but it is not improbable that the state of that part of the country at that time made it necessary for him to assume this authority in order to maintain the public peace." So that's a very direct and personal connection for me. But in this short speech, it's not the Wealth of Nations that is my focus, because I'd like to concentrate... Yes, of course.
Ivan McKee.
Sorry, I can't resist this, but the member mentioned three seminal texts of 1776, including the Declaration of Independence. I'd like to invite the member to say some more about the positive benefits of independence.
Donald Cameron.
Well, I'm very tempted by that red rag to a bull, but I would instead like to concentrate on the theory of moral sentiments, which Ivan McKee himself mentioned. Because it is, I think, it was the work that Smith himself considered to be his masterpiece. It was his first major work, and he saw his role as a moral philosopher to be complementary to his views on economics. And Michelle Thompson mentioned this too, and he wrote about sympathy with the feelings of others, that rather than being simply self-interested, we are in fact deeply concerned with the well-being of humankind. And as one might expect from an Enlightenment figure, Smith was a humanist. He believed in the dignity of the human being. He believed in government intervention to help those in need. And the theory of moral sentiments is the counterweight to the individualism of the kind of proto-capitalist framework that was to come in the Wealth of Nations. And as Vernon L. Smith famously said in a lecture about the theory of moral sentiments and the Wealth of Nations, they together explain why human nature appears to be simultaneously self-regarding and other-regarding. So can I close, Deputy Presiding Officer, by thanking again Michelle Thompson for a worthy debate in honour of a worthy, indeed, titanic figure in Scotland. And I look forward to hearing more contributions from across the chamber.
Thank you very much, Mr Cameron. And I now call Claire Adamson to be followed by Pam Gosell. Around 4 minutes, Ms Adamson.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I'm afraid I don't have the connection that Mr Cameron has just outlined to Adam Smith, but the fact I stand here as the granddaughter of a steelworker in the same parliament as Mr Cameron, I think that would be something that Hume and Hutton and Burns and Adam Smith would possibly welcome. So, Presiding Officer, I recently attended for the first time an event in Panmure House, invited by the Chancellor of Heriot Watt University to a reception to welcome Zambia's distinguished representative, President Hakainde Hichilema, to Scotland. The speeches there emphasise the connections of our countries, the political and global challenges of climate change, of equalities, of feminist equality, climate justice and economic challenges of the Global South. And it was very poignant to hear this in the salon of Adam Smith, whose portrait adorned the walls, albeit painted many years after his death, so we have to use our imagination to determine how accurate that portrait is. But to be there in that salon, you cannot help but pause, imagine the many discussions, arguments and resolutions of the great thinkers of the Enlightenment. And indeed, it seems that the wisdom, intellect and the vision have seeped into the very walls where Adam lived from 1778 until his death in 1790. It's been argued already in the chamber that the inquiry into the nature and causes of the wealth of nations, his opus, is as relevant today as it was on first publication. And like Michelle Thompson, I was also delighted to attend the event at this Parliament to hear about University of Glasgow's Business School's plan to commemorate the tricentenary of one of Scotland's leading thinkers, economists, and perhaps the key figure of the Enlightenment. And by enabling us all to engage more closely with Smith's work and explore his writing, not as an historical artefact, but as ideas that speak to us still today. And while there will hardly be an economics student in the last 300 years who will not have heard of, or indeed in most cases read at least parts of The Wealth of Nations, myself included, in today's Herald, Dr. Craig Smith, Adam Smith's senior lecturer in the Scottish Enlightenment at the University of Glasgow, reminds us that of the other great philosophical writing, The Theory of Moral Sentiments, which has recently been re-examined by scholars having gone out of fashion. And Dr. Smith says it's a book that is, in many respects, as accurate today as it was in the telling, and telling us how we feel when we see somebody being injured, how we feel when we see someone stealing from someone else. So there's a focus on emotion, on the psychology of sympathy and empathy and impartiality. And as Michelle Thompson says, not putting yourselves in favour above anybody else. All these things are still part of how we think and feel about morality today. And Presiding Officer, it should certainly inform the members of this chamber as we pass law impacting on people's lives and as we seek to live up to the standards expected in public life. I congratulate Michelle Thompson on securing the debate, but also congratulate the University of Glasgow's Adam Smith Business School on embracing this opportunity that the Tricentenary presents to celebrate and discuss Adam Smith's legacy through the Smith Around the World lecture series. That spans Sydney, Beijing, Tokyo, the West Indies, Barcelona, Canberra, Mexico City, Toulouse, Hong Kong, Oxford, Nairobi and London. And the fact that the walls of Panmure Salon have extended so far across the globe is the most fitting tribute to this luminary of the Enlightenment. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Ms Adamson. Before I call the next speaker, due to the number of speakers who still want to participate in the debate, I am minded to move a motion without notice under Rule 8.14.3 to extend the debate by up to 30 minutes, and I would invite Michelle Thompson to move such a motion.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that the debate be extended by up to 30 minutes. Are we all agreed? That is agreed. Thank you very much indeed. And I now call Pam Gosell, who will be followed by Ash Regan, around 4 minutes. Ms Gosell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As Shadow Minister for Further and Higher Education,
I'm extremely honoured to be contributing to today's debate, celebrating 300 years since the birth of the father of economics, University of Glasgow alumni and Professor Adam Smith. I thank the member, Michelle Thompson, for bringing forward this motion today. And I will try and contribute a little bit different to Adam Smith. However, I don't have no direct connection, as my colleague Donald Cameron has, but I do have a connection of citing his work in my studies. The Scottish Enlightenment was a period of incredible intellectual and cultural growth in Scotland. It was the catalyst for establishing the importance of reason, scientific inquiry, and individual rights. It laid the groundwork for the Industrial Revolution and the rise of modern capitalism. And it was then that Scotland became a centre of intellectual and cultural excellence, having a lasting impact on Scotland's identity and reputation. Much of Adam Smith's work, particularly The Wealth of Nations, mentioned many times today, is widely regarded as one of the most important works in the history of economics and helped underpin modern capitalism. And we often forget how much of our thinking as politicians is inspired by the ideas and the workings of Adam Smith. For me personally, I understand his work to have emphasised the benefits of the free market and of the limited government interventions. Here and around the world, I and many other students and researchers, past and present, cite his work. In my PhD, I have focused on his work around human capital. However, I do respect the fact that we may all interpret his work differently, as has always been the case. Back then, debate and discussion were central to Scottish Enlightenment. As some of you may be aware, the Scottish Enlightenment was a movement that was centred around ideas and the debate of those ideas. I believe it was my colleague Murdo Fraser who highlighted in the birthplace of the Enlightenment, protesters were able to cancel the screening of adult human female for the second time. This has sparked discussions about whether censorship has captured Scotland's world-class institutions that were once bastions of free speech. The United Kingdom government clearly has similar concerns about universities in England and has since introduced the Higher Education Freedom of Speech Act. This will extend legal responsibilities to universities and student unions to secure freedom of speech and academic freedom while promoting these important values. As the Prime Minister has rightly stressed, a tolerant society is one which allows us to understand those we disagree with, and nowhere is that more important than within our great universities. From today's discussion about the Scottish Enlightenment and influential figure such as Adam Smith, it is my hope that we can all reflect on the values at the heart of that time and what they mean for today's Scotland. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, today's debate, marking 300 years since the birth of Adam Smith, has provided us a unique opportunity to reflect on the values that were the catalyst for modern economics, and indeed the underpinning of modern Scotland's identity and culture. The Scottish Enlightenment was a time characterised by the spirit of open inquiry and the free exchange of ideas, almost contrary to the direction we seem to be headed as a society now. I hope that debates such as this should act as a turning point for the return to a Scotland which stands for logic, reason and debate.
Thank you, Ms. Gozal. I now call Ash Regan to be followed by Stephen Kerr. Around 4 minutes, Ms. Regan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And like others, I commend my colleague Michelle Thompson for securing this debate in the Chamber and for her excellent remarks commemorating the Tercentenary. Adam Smith's ideas have shaped the world as we know it. And the Scottish Enlightenment that he was a leading part of is characterised by Scottish thinkers and intellectual leadership of Europe. It was a movement of ideas and, importantly, disputation of ideas. Smith is most famous, as we've heard this evening, for his book, The Wealth of Nations, but I, like Mr. Cameron, will focus my remarks on his other book, The Theory of Moral Sentiments, which was published in 1759. And this book very much put Mr. Smith on the map. It brought him fame, and also students from other universities, even in other countries, left their university courses to come and study under him in Scotland. And also, it was considered by Smith himself to be his superior work. And I've got a passage from the book here, which I won't read out in its entirety because it's quite long. He's talking specifically about systems, about plans for how we govern. And he's using the analogy of chess pieces. And I'll quote a little bit of it here. He says, "In the great chessboard of human society, every single piece has a principle of motion of its own, altogether different from that which the legislature might choose to impress upon it." And I'll just paraphrase the rest here. So he's talking about if the principles coincide, then the game of human society will go easily. And if they don't, then it will go miserably. And I think, in other words, we can understand what he's saying there, that governments are most successful when they work with people rather than against them. I agree with that. I sense there's a bit of agreement in the chamber for that sentiment too. And I think it's something important for us all to ponder as we go about the work of this legislature as well. So, like Ms. Gozel, I understand and have taken on board Smith's belief in free speech and how that relates to society and modern society, indeed, at the moment. And I think his idea of free speech was also tempered by respect for others and also by empathy for others. And I think he maybe wouldn't understand our modern idea of empathy, but it's certainly based on sentiments that he wrote about in the book. And I think Scottish Enlightenment, it teaches us that we need to be free to think. We need to be free to debate. And we even need to be free to offend. And we need to base our thinking, indeed our critical thinking, on facts and also on science, which was a sentiment that he expressed very much. I think there is immense value in robust debate, that clash of competing opinions, which I think benefits both society and also governments. So Smith and the Enlightenment, they continue to inspire us. They inspire us to that pursuit of knowledge. And they also inspire us to create an environment that encourages that exchange, that free exchange of ideas, because that is how we progress. Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Ms. Reagan. I now call the final speaker in the open debate, Stephen Kerr, around 4 minutes. Mr. Kerr.
It's a pleasure to follow Ash Reagan, who gave an excellent speech. It's impossible to overstate the impact of Adam Smith's thinking on the modern world. He's probably the most influential, universally influential Scot of all time. And I'm going to take one aspect of the many strands of his philosophy to focus on in my speech. Smith believed that with the right measure of regulation, society is empowered. He believed the market is an engine for prosperity when it is legally framed. And this is the definition of a free market that I strongly believe in, because it is a model based on what works best and what works for people. But truthfully, I don't think we have many regulators that we could hold up as being all that good at what they do. Most of them are paper tigers, pretty much toothless. Now, we are a regulatory body, Scotland's Parliament. And we can and should draw inspiration from Smith's thinking in this place, especially when it comes to how we as parliamentarians scrutinise the executive and introduce new laws and regulations and amend existing laws and regulations. And I don't think we are even half as effective at this as we could be. Some of that is related to process, but much of it is derived from the culture of this place. Everything feels truncated and lacking in thoroughness. Too often, things are treated to the level of just surface deep. And people are rightly critical of the quality of the laws that we pass here. And they're even more critical about the lack of enforcement and accountability. And they are concerned that our scrutiny of the executive is not as robust as it ought to be. We don't set the bar high enough in this Parliament on what constitutes good government. And it's often said that we haven't developed a backbench Holyrood culture, that there aren't enough free thinkers in this place. And that is a far cry from the great figures of the Enlightenment. And all of this is highly relevant to Adam Smith and his legacy. Because I don't believe we spend nearly enough time debating, contesting ideas in this chamber. The structure of our debates mitigates against it. And there's seldom enough time to properly engage the more serious and the often complex issues we face. It was the much-missed David McClatchy who said of this Parliament, "We appear to have two options, just two options, to ban something or to make it compulsory." We rarely get to the root causes of the issues we face. We often end up talking to ourselves about symptoms, not root causes. Facing up to our failures, Presiding Officer, as a Parliament, or objectively judging the outcomes or effectiveness of the regulations we put in place isn't easy. Of course it isn't. It's much easier to stick to self-congratulation or to say safely within the debate brief that we've been handed. But up pops Adam Smith to bring us back to root causes and unintended outcomes and the whole issue of human nature. Not human nature as we'd like it to be, but human nature as it is. This is Smith in The Theory of Moral Sentiments, talking directly to us in this Parliament. Of course, he didn't know he was speaking to us, but he was. He wrote, "To judge ourselves as we judge of others is the great exertion of candour and impartiality. In order to do this, we must look at ourselves with the same eyes with which we look at others. We must imagine ourselves not the actors, but the spectators of our own character and conduct." Presiding Officer, we really should let our inner Adam Smith out. We are quick to pass the buck, to blame, but do we really imagine ourselves not the actors, but the spectators of our own character and conduct? 2 years into my service in this Parliament, my answer must be that we can and must do better. But reform of this Parliament is fundamentally essential. Now, last week in a member's debate, Michelle Thompson said something about me and a potato. But I'm going to be as generous as I normally am, Presiding Officer, and say I pay tribute to Michelle Thompson for bringing this debate. I understand that artificial intelligence was beyond answering the question. I got that. But I pay tribute to her, and I don't often agree with her on substantive issues, or maybe frighteningly, increasingly, I do find myself agreeing with her, from her perspective, not from mine, because she's undoubtedly one of the free thinkers of this Parliament. And we need more free thinking. Adam Smith speaks to us as clearly today as he did to those of his day. Let us use this anniversary to reflect, to look at ourselves with the same eyes which we look at others, and be the free thinkers that Scotland needs as never before.
Thank you, Mr. Kerr. I now call on the Minister to respond to the debate. Minister, for around 7 minutes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Let me begin by extending my gratitude to Michelle Thompson, not only for tabling the motion, but for so eloquently setting the scene for the debate, and also to members across the Chamber for their considered insights. Colleagues have already highlighted some of the many achievements of Adam Smith, a great moral philosopher and political economist, as we've heard, one of the key figures in the Scottish Enlightenment. It has been an informative debate. I personally did not know, for example, that Smith had an asteroid named after him, or that he went to university aged 14 to 15. I certainly didn't know that Will Smith may be a descendant. We should be proud of the impact Smith has had and continues to have on Scotland, and indeed the rest of the world. And it's entirely appropriate that we take time today to celebrate Adam Smith 300 years after his birth in Kirkcaldy. These celebrations are happening right across the country, not the least of which would be in Glasgow University, where he was a student, the recipient of an honorary doctorate, later staff member and eventually director. At a speaking engagement there this morning, I was told also that he wrote his theory of moral sentiments at Glasgow University. But in doing all this, I also want to celebrate the role of the Scottish universities have had and to continue to have in the exchange of ideas, in driving innovation on a global scale and in contributing to social justice. During the 18th century, the Scottish Enlightenment, as we know, put our country at the heart of global intellectual discourse. It's fitting that we're speaking here today in Edinburgh, a city which was at the heart of that revolutionary time, a time when there was a constant exchange of ideas between medics and philosophers, engineers and economists, writers and researchers. This interdisciplinary approach provided a fertile breeding ground for the theories and the discoveries that would shape Scotland and the rest of the world for years to come. Smith, as many contributors have noted, was one of the key figures in the Enlightenment. He lived at a time when Scotland was leading the world in thinking, innovation and invention, traits which continue to this day. One of the greatest contributions he and the Enlightenment made to the world was the new emphasis on bringing together talent from across disciplines and crossing the divide between the theoretical and the practical for the public good. Debates on the influence of Smith's work often point to the many ways in which he's been misunderstood. In 2017, the then First Minister, Nicola Sturgeon, acknowledged that Smith is one of the most misquoted and misinterpreted economists in human history. He's often held up as a believer in unrestrained free markets, but a detailed examination of his work arguably shows someone in favour of properly functioning markets which enable a just society to flourish. In The Wealth of Nations, Smith said, "No society can be flourishing and happy, of which the far greater part of the members are poor and miserable." As an academic put it to me this morning, Smith was neither right-wing nor left-wing. He was Adam Smith. The idea of social justice is one which we continue to see reflected in Scotland today. What a fine legacy for a colossus to have left behind. But of course, Presiding Officer, Smith's contributions would not have been possible without the education system and the universities which enabled them to flourish. For centuries, our universities have played leading roles in nurturing the best minds in the country, providing opportunities for discussion, debate and reflection. As we've heard, Adam Smith was educated at the University of Glasgow, an institution whose business school now bears his name. And we have our university system to thank for helping to shape him into the father of modern economics, as he's widely recognised. Our universities, I'm just about to finish if I may, our universities continue to bring together students and staff with different perspectives and life experience. The policy of free tuition and widening access have made this more open to more of our young people than ever before, a fact I suspect Smith would be proud of. Smith's was also the time that saw the dawn of what we now recognise as scientific method, the gathering of evidence and the challenging of previously accepted theories, the idea that people should think for themselves rather than believe what they've been told. Though I'm not sure what he would have made of the role of social media in modern society in the context of thinking for yourself, where it extends to espousing wild conspiracy theories as fact. Yes, of course.
Stephen Kerr.
Grateful to the Minister for giving way. He heard impassioned pleas from Pam Gosal and Ash Reagan about the vital issue of freedom of speech, especially on the campuses of our esteemed universities. Would the Minister take this opportunity to give a categoric statement, unequivocal statement, in support of the right of freedom of speech on the campuses of Scotland's universities?
Minister. And then, officer, freedom of speech matters, as does respect for others, and very often the tone in which we conduct debates is just as important as the debates themselves. Presiding officer, the attributes which Smith advanced remains those of the Scottish research sector today. Scotland has three universities in the top 200 of the 2023 Times Higher Education World University rankings, and each of our 19 higher education institutions conduct world-leading research across a breadth of disciplines, and almost half of it is undertaken with international collaborators. That interconnectedness of people, cultures, facilities, data, knowledge and ideas is the means by which we have the chance to solve some of the world's most difficult problems, from the climate crisis to child poverty. Presiding officer, as the motion for this debate rightly notes, we should be proud, deeply proud, of Adam Smith's legacy and of the continued role Scotland's universities play in leading the exchange of ideas. I'm confident that we will continue to nurture more great thinkers in Scotland's future, a future based upon the wisdom of Adam Smith and the Scottish Enlightenment. Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting of Parliament.